Let's start. Is that okay? Let's talk about baptism this morning, okay, because we're going to be baptized. This is actually a series. I have to cram it all into one, so please forgive me if I speak too quickly, too fast, whatever, but it's a lot, okay? So I have to cram it in, zip it, PK zip, whatever, zip, you know, computer style, zip, and condense it quickly, but I just want to go through some stuff, okay? So baptism, we know there's various controversy about baptism and so forth, and whatever, but so we're going to get in the lube on it. If there's more questions, please come afterwards and ask or whatever, or see me when it's possible. But we're going to talk about baptism. What does it mean? Who can do it? Why not? Why this? Why that? Whatever. So I want you to get understanding this morning. It's not what I say, but I pray that the Holy Spirit revealed to you this morning. Okay? Okay. Baptism is a statement of faith, not a law of works. It is answering the call of the obedience with what God has placed within you. Okay? So it's not something you have to do. You better do it. Otherwise, if you don't do it, you're going to go to hell. Okay? You better do it. Otherwise, you're not as holy as somebody else. Whatever. Okay? So it's an obedience thing that, you know, there's a call and you submit into that. And you know in your heart, you need to do this. Okay? I want to explain to you a little bit in my life. Before I got baptized, you know, I had supernatural encounters with the Lord. I didn't understand baptism in a way, but I remember before I got baptized, I had various dreams and visions. But one of the dreams and visions that I had, it was two massive angels took me. Massive angels, one on the left, one right. They actually took me, and then they actually flew with me. And they took me into the deepest part of the ocean, and they buried me, okay? So there was something really stirring within me. Then I had another dream that I had. Then I was buried, okay? And also I was buried, and I came out of it. And when I came out of it, this coffin and stuff, I remember there was two ladies, one on the left, one on the right, and they were in the hospital. And as I came out, I took the hands and the power of God knocked me and knocked them. Okay? So God was already ministering to me. It's like, and I knew I need to get baptized. I didn't understand it. Nobody really ministered to me. I remember when I was a little boy, and when I was about 16 years old, you know, they said, you better get baptized, otherwise you're going to hell. So what did I do? I got baptized. Okay? Out of condemnation. Do you hear what I'm saying? So I know understanding, I did it out of religious obligation and out of fear of God. I don't want to miss heaven, okay, and go to hell. That was my motivation. So we need to understand there must be a greater motivation concerning baptism, okay? Now, if you look at water, okay, you can look at God and water. Holy Spirit hovered over, brooded over the face of the deep, okay? So we already see that in the beginning, in Genesis, we already saw there was water, you know. Okay, it was not like this thing that I've got also a whole series on evolution and stuff. They said we come out of this brothel and whatever, and we became a single cell organism, and then we did evolve. That's nonsense. We don't evolve, you know, and like that anyway. So just make sure of that, you know. So, but there was water already in the beginning. Also need to understand, especially... I've heard it, you know, when you're pregnant. I wouldn't really know, but I heard from women that when you're pregnant, you actually are protecting the baby water. There's water around the baby, protecting the baby, okay? So you need to see as well, water is something very interesting that actually protects as well. Also of the human body as well, you know, consists of water. I think it's 75 something percent, give or take, or something. I don't know. I'm not sure. But your body consists mainly of water. Okay? And almost 2/3 of the earth is consisting of water. So God's got something to do with water, I would say. No? And also talk about, you know, Holy Spirit, you know, rivers of living water will gush from your belly. There's so many references concerning water, okay, in the Bible. There's a lot. And there is a lot more. But in Genesis 1 verse 1, the Amplified says here, in the beginning, God prepared, formed, fashioned, and created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and was empty and waste, and darkness was upon the face of the great deep. The Spirit of God was moving, hovering, brooding over the face of the water. Okay? So basically there is something in water as well that's beautiful. When it rains, it creates life. Isn't it right? Do we need rain at the moment? Why? Because things is dying. So water is very needed for. Okay? So we need to see that God has something to do with water. And it's a beautiful thing, water. We love water. My wife's got so much fountains there in our house. I just want to pee all the time. Okay? Let's just be very real about that, you know? You know? It's water and water and water. I'm like, drink the water. Where's Johan? Bathroom. So, my wife loves water, but it also, if you go to a waterfall and stuff, it brings calmness within you. It brings some tranquility within you, you know? It just does something for your soul. It does something to you, water. Isn't it right? It can cool you down. You can play on it. You can enjoy it. The sea. Who loves the sea? I mean, come on. Who sleeps well at the sea? Why? That noise and stuff. It's making noise, but it's a calming effect over you. Okay? God's voice is also like a rushing water and stuff like that as well. So it's really amazing stuff, people. So God is into something about water. So just to encourage you. But I'm going to just give you a bit of background to see, you know, where also how much water was actually in the beginning, okay? Now, Genesis 1 verse 6, you know, it talks here to verse 10. Genesis 1 verse 6 to verse 10. Okay, I think it's the New King James Version. But I want you to explain how awesome water is. Because it talked about a baby, you know. Now, I want to show you how the earth in the beginning was encapsulated, okay, as well like a baby. Pretty cool stuff. It says here, then God said, let there firmament in the midst of the water, and let it divide the waters from the deep. Very interesting. I did a whole teaching on that. Thus God made the firmament that divided the waters which were under the firmament. So there was something above, and there was waters on top, and there was water beneath. Okay? And God called the firmament heaven. Now the word firmament heaven is actually water. Okay? So the evening and the morning were the second day, and God said, let the waters under the heavens gather together into one place, and the dry land appeared, and it was so it became a sea, and then it was dry land as well. And God called the dry land earth, and gathering together of the waters, he called sea, and God saw that it is good. There's my board there. I didn't bring it now in the front. But what happened is, if this was the earth here, then around this was a firmament of water. You know, if you studied, there was water around the earth. Today, if scientists say there's actually water around the earth, little twinklings around it still from that day. So what happened is, I'm not going to go into it, you can get the teaching, it actually amplified sound. Now what happened is that firmament actually amplified the stars and everything that makes music. You know, today scientists actually go and they say that the stars are giving off sound. You know, sound waves, and God spoke, and that universe is called a single spoken sentence. That's what universe means. God spoke. So there's sound waves all over, and every molecule, even in this place, everywhere, there is even sound molecules are detecting, okay? Pretty cool stuff. But there was a firmament around the earth as well. So God encapsulated the earth before the fall, okay? And like a baby, wanted to protect it. But of course, people messed up, you know, and things happened like that, okay? And so it was dissipating and so forth. So what actually the word firmament actually means, extended surface, solid or expanse. Okay? The firmament or a vault of heaven supporting waters above. That's what it means. Considered by Hebrews a solid and supporting water above by the Hebrews. Okay? So that there was water around the earth like a baby being protected. That's how it actually was. Also, we saw a little bit of Noah. You know Noah? You know? Noah's boat. He was... No, that was New Skokuni. Okay, it was a boat, okay? Okay, we're not going to go into details about that, law theology in that. But also, you know, God basically restored the earth. People also see the destroying, but also God healed the earth as well, okay, through Noah. And also the water removed the wickedness and brought into purity as well, okay. Then another example as well, I'm not going to go into all the scriptures, but as well, Israel, you know what happened to the, when they came out of Egypt, then they went through the Red Sea. Now that sea was a type of baptism, isn't it right? They went through the waters to leave the old and getting to the new. It was a prophetic utterance, basically, to leave the old behind and getting to the new, okay? So also the Israelites went through a type of baptism there in the wilderness, okay? Then we have a lot of bad stuff always going. This is, if you never heard about this stuff, please, if you never heard of this, awesome stuff. But people talk about water spirits and this spirits and whatever spirits and watch out for that spirits. You know, people always say, but water is bad, water is bad. And sometimes you see water fountains by a church and the first thing is, oh, that's bad because they have a Leviathan spirit. Such junk, you know. You know, they're busy with water spirits because they see the fountains by the church. No, it's just a fountain. You know what I'm saying? So people get very carried away with the stuff. So I want to tell you, says Psalm 74, verse 14. Psalm 74, verse 14 says, you crush the heads of the Leviathan. Actually, in brackets, the Egyptians. You did give him and him as food for the creatures, inhabitants of the wilderness. So it's been destroyed. The water spirits, Sedungus. Do you hear what I'm saying? No more water spirits and stuff, whatever. Is there a lot of spirits and demons? Of course there is. But not in this place. Not because people get carried away with the stuff. They look for demons and everything. You know? Bible talks in Mark 3 verse 14 to 15 that it says that you have the power to heal the sick and to cast out demons. So what spirit of demon of water spirit is going to come against you if there is such a thing? Nothing. So just to give clarify a little bit of that silly doctrine that comes into place as well. You know, if you've been in charismatic circles, you know, especially, you know, you hear this stuff. Just to break that, I'll just minister a little bit on it. I'm not going to go into detail with that. But that's also taboo stuff, okay? Now, Naaman. Second Kings, okay? If you're Afrikaans, you understand that, okay? Second Kings 5 verse 10. This is also what happens here about water and being cleansed and so forth. And Elisha sent the messenger to him, this is from verse 10, saying, go and wash in the Jordan 7 times, your flesh shall be restored to you, and you shall be clean. In other words, this was the guy with great authority, this oak. And Elijah was a prophet. So this man was a bit of, he got a little bit of pride issue in his life, okay? And he was not even of a tribe of Israel. He was a foreigner. So God heals foreigners as well, you know? Okay? Heathens, he can heal them, okay? No problem. So he says, now Elijah gives him this thing. He says, listen, go and wash yourself 7 times. The number 7 means perfect. That's what it means. 7 means perfect. You are restored unto him, you shall be cleaned. But Naaman became furious and went away and said, indeed, I said to myself, he will surely come out and stand and call upon the name of the Lord of his God. It's not my God, your God. It's amazing. God simply has compassion upon him. And wave his hand over this place and heal the leprosy. Because he was a leper. So you just go like, you're fine. But there's sometimes they will be require a thing of faith. That's what you're going to do today. It's called a faith thing that you are doing. You are actually establishing where your faith is at, that I'm doing something. Isn't it right? So, and now he's a bit upset. And now his servant says, are not Abna and the far farther rivers of Damascus better than all the rivers, all the water of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean? So he turned and went away in his rage. Why did he say this? Because that river actually is dirty. I don't know if you've ever been to Egypt and stuff like that. The Nile River is not a pretty sight, people. It's dirty. Still today. It's very dirty, okay? So he was furious to do this. So he turned away and went in rage. And his servant came near and spoke to him and said, my father, if the prophet had told you to do something great, would you not have done it? Because he's a prophet. Like I said to people, I'm a prophet. I will tell you why. To help you, not to hurt you. I might tell you something to do something silly, but there's a reason for this. Okay? Jesus was a prophet. He will say things to you. Doesn't make sense, but go and do it. It's what happening here today. It's a prophetic thing. Go and do it. Doesn't always make sense, but go and do it. And he says here, so he went down and dipped 7 times in the Jordan, according to the saying of the man, and his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. Do you see what it does? It brings it cleanses you. You'll see what we're going to get into other scriptures as well. But it made his flesh like a baby. It restored his youth. It restored his youth. We're going to get into that stuff. So there's some stuff I'm going to say that please don't get offended, but it's what Jesus said. I want you to open your heart here this morning and open your mind to receive the trueness of the Lord concerning the Word of God. Not your carnal thinking, but your spiritual thinking here this morning, okay? You cannot read the Bible with your mind. You have to read with your born-again spirit, okay? So he was clean. So this is what's going to be happening. The same thing. It's like you are born again. You are new. When you go into the waters, out of it, like you are fresh, brand spanking new, like a fresh, baby coming into this world. Amen. Now the word baptismo or baptized, if you want to know, it means to be dip repeatedly. I won't do that to you, okay? Maybe tomorrow, but not today. Okay? To immerse, to submerge, or vessel, or to sink. To cleanse by dipping or submerging, to wash, to make clean with water, to wash oneself, to bath, to overwhelm. This is an overwhelming thing. Before you're going to get into that baptismal pool, you're going to feel like it's an overwhelming thing. It's like, well, I just want to get baptized. No, you can feel that maybe you shake a little bit, maybe there's something stirring in you. It's an overwhelming thing. We're going to the water, come out of the water. There is something that will happen in you and through you. It is an overwhelming thing. So you've got to go under the water and out of water. We'll see the reason why we do this. So the word baptism means to be submerged, to be under the water and out again. Jesus was baptized. We do the same. Okay? So you need to see that the original word in the New Testament is actually called dunker. John, not the Baptist, John the Dunker. So the times that you Baptist. Okay. So you do a Oma. You know? Any Oma's gonna be doped today? Okay. Means to dunk. You dunk under the water. So that's actually what it means to dunk under, totally, to overwhelm. Now, the touchy subject is christening, claim dope for the Afrikaans people, you know. Is it scriptural or not? Unfortunately, it is not. Or I would say, fortunately, christening, claim doop is not scriptural, okay? And I'll explain to you the reason why, okay? So please, outside of people, please don't get offended with me, but I want to minister on stuff that's in the Word of God. I want you to understand this and know this, okay? Because people do it because the pastor, the dominee, whatever, you've been doing it, your mom's doing it, but nobody gave you understanding why are you doing this. Okay, so I say many times to people, when I minister here, and you think, I don't agree with that, then come and speak to me, and show me whatever, and then we can talk about this. Is that okay? And then we don't want to fight about it. I want to say, let's talk about what the Bible says. I don't fight with people. I said, let's go to the Word, and I explain to you A, B, and C. Not because this guy wrote a book, or because this dominee is saying, or this pastor is saying this, whatever. We have to look what the Word of God says concerning christening, okay? There's no such thing as christening or claim doop, okay? The reason why the christening stuff came in to the church was because of the Jewish circumcision. So what happened is, with time, what happened is, they say, okay, the baby on the 8th day, they're not going to circumcise anymore, but they're going to christen. They're going to do the christening thing, whatever, okay? But baptize them, basically. Okay, so that's the stuff that came into to the church many years after that. Now what happened, the Lord revealed to me, when you are christening a baby, actually, it puts a religious veil before their eyes. That's what a lot of people, when they are christened, to actually come to the full truth, it's very hard. You know, they fight for the stuff and very religious. Yeah, but you must like that. There's a very hard thing. It's like a religious veil. That's like the law was put upon the eyes. We'll see in 2 Corinthians. Talks about the law blinds the people. Now, blinds people to come to the full truth, okay, to what God has truly done for them. But that christening thing was actually coming in basically on the eighth day because of the Jewish circumcision. And they said, no, what? I'm not going to get into too much of it. But I said, no, wait, we're going to circumcise. We're going to just do the baptism thing, okay? So that's where it actually came from. But I want to show you something interesting about this as well in 2 Corinthians 25 to 29. To give you a bit of understanding about circumcision and so forth. Okay, some people still have this whole thing, you must be circumcised, and this is how it is, and no, it's not how it is, okay? So Romans 2:25 says, for circumcision it's indeed profitable if you keep the law, but if you are a breaker of the law, your circumcision has become uncircumcised, so it means nothing. Therefore, if an uncircumcised man keeps the righteousness requirements of the law, will not his uncircumcision be counted as circumcision, okay? So even if you're not circumcised, but this was under the Old Testament, you kept it, it means you're sweet. Because the law is better than the circumcision. That's what he was saying. And will not the physical uncircumcised, if he fulfills the law, judge you, who even with your written code, meaning the law, that Moses, the stuff, and circumcision are a transgressor of the law. For he is not a Jew who is outwardly, nor a circumcision that which is outwardly in the flesh. But he is a Jew, he's inwardly. And our circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, not the letter. The letter means the law, whose praise is not from men, but from God. In other words, what he was saying is that it means the law. We want to do so much, so do. Like I said in the beginning, what you are doing here now, it's not a law thing. It's an obedience thing. Why do we sometimes do, Johan, you do this, you do this. It's not the law, it's a principle that I do out of faith and out of grace, okay? So what we do, and that true Jew is now the circumcision of the heart, not of the flesh, snip anymore. When I got born again, something changed within me. And I was like, wow, my eyes went open to the truth. You see what I'm saying? That is what actually is happening. A lot of people say, what happens now if I was christened or whatever? Don't worry. You know, we all made mistakes. Me three. Okay? You know, your parents didn't know. That's why they christened you. They didn't know. Don't judge them for it. Some other pastors do me whatever. They don't know. It's fine. Bless them. But now you know better. That is the difference. The reason why I'm saying is, there is no place in the New Testament, even in the Old, talking about christening. There's not one single verse that you can show me in the Bible talks about christening. Yeah, but you're just doing it because you want to say we're dedicating. Now, dedicating, you dedicate your baby, you bring your baby to the front, and we as a man of God, we anoint and we bless your baby and dedicate it to the Lord. That's how you dedicate your baby. Not by christening, not by kleindoop. That's not how you do it. You dedicate, you bring your child to the front. We all stand in agreement, the whole congregation blesses your child and send it out for the future, you know, and bless you as man and woman and father and mother for your children as well. That's how you do it, okay? That's why I want to say to you, in the New Testament, there's nothing even old about christening, okay? So, because Revelation 22:18 says this. It's quite hectic words, but it's the truth. People add to the word because it's just nice. Your traditions, the Bible says, nullify the power of God. We have a lot of wrong traditions in churches that is causing serious damage in people's lives, okay? So we need to understand what Revelation 22:18 says this. It says, for if I testify to anyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book, if anyone adds to these things, God will add to him the plagues that are written in this book. If anyone takes away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God will take away his part from the book of life, from his holy city, from the things which are written in this book. You see, that's why a lot of stuff happens to people, because in churches they just do it because it's nice. I don't say we don't do nice things, but there's traditions that overpowers the word of God, and you can't have that. And that is the problem. While people have the cycle in life happening all the time and causing problems in the life, because I put stupid traditions into place. Okay. Now we're going to look at quickly at John the Baptist in Matthew 3 verse 13. Because there was John the Baptist, the dunker. Dom de Danke. That sounds so strange. I don't think we're going to do that. And Jesus came to Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. And John tried to prevent him, saying, I need to be baptized by you. So John says, No. You need to baptize me. And you are coming to me. But Jesus answered him, Permit it to be so now, for thus it's fitting for us to fulfill the righteousness. All righteousness. Then he allowed him. In other words, he says, No. He says, no, you need to baptize me. And what does the word baptize mean? Baptize, baptismo, be dunked under the water. So that's what would Jesus do? You know the bands? What did Jesus do? Isn't it right? So we follow what Jesus is doing. Isn't it right? That's how we should do. Be like. So it says here, and when he had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately. So Jesus said, he came up. He didn't go like sprinkle water. He says he went out and he came up out of the water. Okay? Immediately from water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove, alighting upon him. And suddenly a voice came out of heaven saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. So when you get baptized, exactly the same thing comes. It said, you're out of the water, and out of the water, it's like, angels are singing, and God is saying, I am well pleased. This is my son, or this is my daughter. I'm so well pleased with you. It's just the same thing that Jesus did. We do the same. It's not a law, okay? It's not a you better. It's out of obedience in what Jesus did, we're doing the same. Do you hear what I'm saying? Because there's a lot of stuff that we do in the charismatic churches, the Pentecostal churches. It becomes law. Praying in tongues becomes also law. No, we'll get to that just now. You see, and it talks about as well, the Great Commission as well. After you've been baptized, you can also go and baptize people. Not just the pastor. You can also do the same. And it says here in Mark 16, the Amplified, verse 15 to 16 says, Mark 16, verse 15 to 16 says, and he said to them, go into the world and preach and publish, open the good news, the gospel to every creature. In other words, the gospel, Jesus marks you. The good news, not the bad news. The end times is here. Okay. Jesus preached life. He never preached no death. And he believes and adhered to trust and relies on the gospel of, and him who is set forth and is baptized will be saved from the penalty of eternal death. But he who does not believe, do not adhere and trust and rely on the gospel of him who is set forth, he will be condemned. In other words, God says, I give you the authority to go and heal the sick, raise the dead, baptize people. You have the authority. You say, but how must I baptize? Man, we'll fill your bath with water and we'll baptize you if you want to be baptized in your water. In that. You know? God is such grace as well. I mean, the one lady, she really had nothing. You know, she didn't have the bath, not whatever, and what happened, she took literally, you know, a bucket of water. You know, like you get your ice challenge bucket water? Because you would submerge on the water. God gave grace for that as well. Okay? Do you hear what I'm saying? Say, so you can do that if it's God's give you grace for the stuff. But it's something that washes you, cleanses you. Now I want to talk a little bit about the Holy Spirit because it's also a very important part of a believer's life. Again, I say to people, it doesn't mean I'm not telling you must be baptized. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying you must be filled with the Holy Spirit and praying tongues. I'm not saying that. You choose. God says in Old Testament even, I set before you life and death, blessings and curses, but choose life. You don't have to choose it. Again, we don't say you must. I'm saying it will be good for you, but you choose. God does not force you to do anything. Do you know that? Do you know that your will is stronger than God's? Your will is stronger than God's. Come tonight, I'll tell you more about that. God says left, you say, stuff this, I'm going right. God says, okay. Isn't it right? You have an opportunity to be healed. No, thank you. God says, no, thank you. You see what I'm saying? Your will is stronger than God. So God will say, no, whenever you're ready. God's not going to force you and pluck you out of your chair and you better, you going to. He's a gentleman, man. Come on. Holy Spirit, Acts 1 verse 4. Well-known passage in the Bible, Acts 1 verse 4 to 5. It says, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you heard from me. And for John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with Holy Spirit not many days from now. Now, one of the other baptisms which is awesome, you know, if you've not been filled with the Holy Spirit, never have been overwhelmed by the Holy Spirit, tonight is your time, your opportunity to do so. Even today, if you want to be, you know, I was overwhelmed by the Holy Spirit so many times. It's pretty awesome. So you can also, so there's a baptism of Holy Spirit, okay, which people do not fully understand or grasp, okay. It's like when I prayed for the lady, it was an overwhelming thing. Why? It's the Holy Spirit, okay. So you see, there is a Holy Spirit, the baptism of Holy Spirit that we also need. And people and the devil and society wants to keep you from Holy Spirit. Okay? You're all ready for baptism. You're all ready for being filled with the Holy Spirit. But there's so much religiousness and stuff and things put into you that you don't want that because you're scared. Because of the movies and the stuff that you see. Of the devil and the demons and all that kind of stuff. Now you think God's going to do the same. Overwhelming, you're going to start foaming at the mouth. And that's why you don't want the Holy Spirit. Because you think God's the same. It's not the truth. There's been junk put into your mind concerning Holy Spirit. Now it says here in Acts 2 verse 1. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind and filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then it appeared to them a divine tongues as of fire, and one sat upon of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. In other words, then while they were sitting one accord, they were praying, waiting for the promise as Jesus was saying. And then the promise came and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. In sunny, Zopro, Hobre, Sebra, Shontro, Shebrakandro, Me, Zonomo, Shebraka, Lenando, Shetikilakato, Betlikitaraka, Shontro, Shebele, Zontotum, Kato, Me, Kato, Robo, Shendra, Kato, Montoto. Holy Spirit came upon them. Okay? So that's what you can receive as well. No person is exempt. You can have the same. I also got the same. Okay? So it's for them and it's for you. Because you need to, that's also another baptism what we also need to focus on. Now Acts 2 verse 37 says now, Acts 2 verse 37 to 41. Now I'm going very quickly through the scriptures. Please forgive me. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart because Peter was ministering this good news. They were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said to him, repent. In other words, repent means to change your mind. Okay. Metanoia, actually the proper word. Now your mind and your ideas is intertwined with God. Not what you think or the pastor or what is intertwined with one another. It says repent to change. And he says here, then Peter said, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for remissions of sins, and you shall receive the gift of Holy Spirit. Okay? So they said, that's what we should do. What we did it unfortunately wrong in the church is when you are born again, you should actually be filled with the Holy Spirit and baptized in one session. Because there's one baptism. But what we do because of the stuff that comes into church, now you get born again and maybe a couple of months later you get baptized and then a couple of months later, then you get filled with the Holy Spirit and praying in tongues. Or you get whatever, vice versa. But it should be actually what? Get born again, Spirit-filled, baptized, Spirit-filled, one place. That's why I have a pool now there at the back, permanently. So you want to get all at once, we do all at once. Okay? That's actually how God intended it to be. But God's got grace for all of us. So he did increments for everybody. A little bit. He gives you grace for it. It's not his perfect will, but he gives you grace for it. Thank God for that grace. Amen. Then he says, And with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from the perverse generation. Because that's what it does. It saves you from this wickedness in this world. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and they were about 3,000 souls that were added to them. Okay, so 3,000 people got baptized that day and spirit-filled. That's pretty cool. Acts 19 verse 1. Now it's a bit of the same thing that happens here. And it happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper region, came to Ephesus and finding some disciples. He said to him, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? They said to him, we have not so much as heard whether there is a Holy Spirit. So they understood, they don't know, they were disciples, but they'd never heard about Holy Spirit. And he said to them, into what then were you baptized? So they said, into John's baptism. I said, okay, that's a bit old, but yes, okay, we were there. Then Paul said, John indeed baptized with baptism of repentance, because he was leading the way about repent, change your mind, receive Jesus. This is the anointed one. You receive this. That's what John the Baptist was pointing to Jesus. Believe on him who would come after him, that is on Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Now, we're going to get into that. People say, we baptize in your name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. That is not scriptural, okay? It was one death, not three, okay? And Paul had laid his hand on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied. You see what it does? Laid hands on them and stuff, and they prophesied, and awesome things happened. And when the men were about 12 in all. And when they went into synagogues and spoke boldly for 3 months, reasoning and persuading concerning the things of the kingdom. So what does it happen? When you get born again, you get spiritual, get baptized, you get boldness like a lion. People say to me, oh, John, I can't be like you. You can. You know, when I got baptized, stuff like that, man, I'm telling you, I chased people in the streets. Said, you need Jesus. People run. You know, I was so bold. I spoke everywhere, whatever. That's what happened to me because there's such boldness. Okay, I was a bit still stupid. Don't get me wrong. I didn't have much wisdom, but I know you need Jesus. So I chase people. You need Jesus. So I had this Messiah syndrome to save everybody. God says, I've already did it. You don't have to do it again. Okay? Relax. Okay? So I was boldness. Still today, now I have still a lot of boldness, but I have wisdom with this boldness. So that's when you get baptized and spirit-filled. You use such boldness to speak. Because the Holy Spirit overwhelms you, and he speaks through you and that kind of stuff. The same thing with people said to me, you know, Johanna, you speak in front of people. It looks like it's so easy for you. I could not speak before people. My neck got stiff. My back ached. And I sit like this. I was frightened to speak. Yeah, I'm telling you, I was like, walk off the stage like this. That's how I, but when I got filled with the Holy Spirit, I got baptized. Man, I spoke with boldness. Smith Wigglesworth, the same thing. Awesome mentor. I love him. He's gone to be with the Lord. You know, love his books as well. He could not speak. Then he got filled with the Holy Spirit and baptized. Man, and his wife, Polly, looked at me and says, that's not my Smithy. Because he reckoned he's starting, was afraid, whatever. And when he got this boldness to speak, that's what the Holy Spirit does. And he baptized that. You have this boldness to speak before people. He said, I can't. With the Holy Spirit, you can. A lot of people say you must be baptized first and then you get Holy Spirit. Doesn't mean that. Doesn't mean that. It says in Acts 10 verse 44, here's an example. While Peter was still speaking these words, he was busy ministering to the people like you sitting here, I was ministering. Then the Holy Spirit fell upon those who heard the word. What's important, you need to hear word. A lot of people don't hear word, then there's no change. You need word continuously every single day. Bible says by the washing of the word, isn't it? Washes, cleanses. The word that I preach and teach washes you, cleanses you. It's like water. You see, that what happens, and those who are of the circumcision who believed were astonished as many as came forth. Peter became, because the gift of the Holy Spirit has been poured out onto Gentiles. For they heard them speaking with tongues and magnifying God. Then Peter answered, can anyone forbid water that these should be baptized who received the Holy Spirit just as we have. And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord, and that he asked him to stay for a few days. In other words, before they were baptized, they got to receive the Holy Spirit. When I received the Holy Spirit, then I was baptized. Do you hear? But you need all of them if you want to, okay? I want you to understand this. I try to explain to people this. Are you born again? Sweet. You can stay like that forever and a day. No problem. If you should die, you're going to be with Jesus. Awesome. Okay, if you want to go with that. But I try to explain to people, get all three. Born again, spirit-filled, baptized. The reason why I'm saying this, I try to use an analogy. I like cars. I'm a guy. Okay? So, it's like this. You are born again. Good, you get a car, but it's a Folksy. 1969 Folksy. It's got four wheels, no problem. You need to go to Cape Town, no problem. You can get in your Folksy, 1969 model, okay? You'll get to Cape Town 20 hours later, but there is no air conditioning. You have no petrol card. You might have a couple of breakdowns. You know, the sound system, it's not so great. You have a wind system, you know. Okay, especially go through the Karoo or some that other place, you know, go to Cape Town. It's like very hot, you know. Rolling the windows down makes it worse. But will you get to Cape Town? Eventually, okay. Does it have four wheels? No problem. It's not maybe the best looking car, but it's okay. But now God has given you an opportunity. So listen, I give you now this. I give you a Porsche 911 Turbo. And the guy says, amen. You know? Or Nissan GTR or something like that. Or BMW M5 or M3, M4, whatever, you know, 750, whatever you desire. But something that has air conditioning, power steering, it's got a petrol card, paid for, okay? You drive in style all the way down. Do you have ups and downs? Yes. But the ups and downs can be managed much better because you have a different gear, much stronger engine, stuff like that to handle it. Am I right? Now that's the same thing I try to explain to people. You get baptized, spirit-filled, all stuff. So you have the same concept to actually equip you to go through this life much easier. Because also the Bible talks about the anointing means to rub, to smear, to make things better. So the Spirit of God is in you and upon you to make things better. Q20, WD-40 or some oil makes things looser and easier. That is what this does. In other words, 1 Corinthians 14 verse 1 says this as well. It says here, pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. In other words, you must desire as well to pray in tongues. Doesn't matter what I speak here, you must desire this. I want this. Okay, I don't always understand it, but I want this gifting, man. I also want to prophesy. I also want to lay hands on the sick. You need to desire this stuff. People ask me, one, I see you have the gift of healing. I said, yeah. But I have the word of knowledge, prophetic stuff. I've got all the gifts. Why? I desire all of them. But if you desire just one, you just get one. I'm greedy. I want all. You see, I want all of God, not just some. I want the gift that I don't want that. I want all of them. You see, you need to desire it. That's why Luke 11:13 says as well, how do you receive it? And the Bible says in Luke 11:13 says, if you then being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give you the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Ask. Not working, not fasting, you know. Just ask. Lord, and lay hands like Paul did. Lay on you. I can blow upon you like Jesus did. And what happened is you receive Holy Spirit. And suddenly, Zopro Shebrahasian, the power of God overwhelms you, fall over, and some of you pray for people, and now they don't get the full thing yet, and then wipe it in your car, in your bathroom, on the toilet, I don't know when, you receive, you receive Holy Spirit. Okay? It's for everybody. But God wants to give it to you, but nobody has taught you because now I'm giving you word and it should work with your heart here. My tongues change regularly. Okay, I don't just have one. But in the beginning, it might sound like a baby. Okay? Now, 1 Corinthians 14:14 says this. Because you have to know the tongues, you can't do tongues in the church, and tongues is only for specific people, and tongues is evil, and blah, blah, blah. But let me explain to you how it works. For if I pray in tongues, my spirit pray, but my understanding is unfruitful. So many times I'll pray in the spirit, I will not understand. But sometimes I will pray in the Holy Spirit and I will understand. Okay? The Holy Spirit, because our mind has not been renewed to actually hear exactly what the Spirit is saying. And the devil hates tongues because it confuses him. Because it's God praying to God and the devil doesn't know what to do. It confuses him. Do you hear? So when you pray in the Holy Spirit, you might not always understand. So I said to people, please, if you pray in tongues for me. Because then you might go, and I said, I better, you know, Johan, Lord, you made a prayer. Johan better get with the prayer. Because I said, Lord, I'm praying for Johan. Lord, the perfect will and plan is when you pray in the Holy Spirit for somebody. Because it's God praying to God for you or for somebody. Amen. And then something will come into your heart and suddenly you get a vision. And God says, speak this over him or her. It opens stuff. It says here, what is the conclusion? I will pray with the Spirit, and I will also pray with understanding. Lord Jesus, I praise you. Lord, I thank you, Lord, Father, my brother. Lord, I declare your goodness, Father. Lord, I thank you for your... You see what I'm saying? That also with the understanding. I will sing with the Spirit. You see, I also sing with understanding. You've heard me sing. I'm not going to sing. Okay? Okay? But you can sing with the understanding. Normal words. Do both, not just the one. I sing, I do both, I declare, I do all of one. And I read my Bible many times at the same time. Okay? Otherwise, if you bless with the Spirit, you will also, how will he also occupy the place of the uninformed? Amen. At your giving of thanks, since he does not understand what you are saying. In other words, we need to do both. Because sometimes people come in, you hear me praying in tongues, and like, ooh, this is a freaky place. But you also pray with the understanding so the person can also understand. The problem why the church don't like the tongues is because you get some yaffles. They just stand up out of the chair and start. They just jump out of the chair and start going like, and they sit down. Now the whole church is like, what the heck? What happened? What's wrong? This guy's getting a seizure or something. So it causes problems in the church. Do you hear? But if I can pray with the tongues, there's somebody else to interpret, then it's awesome. Or like sometimes myself, what I do is I pray in tongues and I interpret. You've heard me done it many a times. No. You can do that. Because it freaks out people. It causes problems. People think we're crazy and nuts. Okay. That's why we don't do the kind of stuff. If you should jump up now and stop praying in tongues, I'm going to chase you out. I say, what are you doing? Because they're great. Now interpret for me, please. So we can hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. Then that's sharp. No problem. That's why this tongue thing caused problems in the church of people like, no, we don't pray in tongues. From the devil. That's from God. Okay. It says here, 1 Corinthians 14 verse 18 says, I thank my God, this is Paul speaking, that I speak with tongues more than you all. This is Paul speaking. So Paul's saying he's weighing the Jews when it comes to spirit. He prays more than all. See how it's important, tongues? To pray in the Holy Spirit. Sometimes you feel like, I don't know why I feel like this. You need to fill your spirit. You need to hold the milis in here. You need to work with this. You need to pray in tongues. Bible says, in Jude, build yourself up praying your most holy of faith. Praying in the Holy Spirit. In Jude 1:20. It builds you up so you can be already. A lot of people get up in the morning, I don't know why I feel like, go through the day, I don't know why I feel like that. Because you are dry. You need, the Bible says, be continuously filled with the Holy Spirit. You are filled with it. You have God's fullness. But you have to stir that fullness by praying in the Holy Spirit. Therefore, 1 Corinthians 14:39. Look at this, what he's saying. Therefore, brethren, desire earnestly to prophesy and do not forbid to speak in tongues. So we shouldn't forbid it. Let all things be done decently and in order. Do you see? But people don't do it in order. That's why church doesn't want it. Do you hear what I'm saying? And praying in tongues doesn't mean you're mature. Healing the sick and raising the dead doesn't mean you're mature. Do you know that? Just means you have gifting. That's it. How many people are very wealthy? And you see they have no understanding of, you know, if you see what they do in their houses and stuff, they got no fashion sense, you know, things that they do and how they treat some of the people. Do you see? You know a lot of people that's wealthy, but they're not clever. True. Do you hear what I'm saying? And a lot of people that's got a great education, still not very lucky upstairs. Huh? Do you hear what I'm saying? Now, what does baptism mean for you? What does it mean for you? It says here in Colossians 2:11, it says this. In him you were also circumcised with a circumcision made with hands, by putting off the body of the sins and of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. Buried with him in baptism. We're going to get to in Romans 6 just now. Romans 6. But see, you're buried with him in baptism. So now you're also buried, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. So you're going to die today. And you being dead in your trespass and uncircumcision of the flesh, he made alive together with him, having forgiven your trespasses. It says, so what happens now? The true circumcision happens. Your old life is going to be cut off today. The true circumcision. Having wiped out their handwritten requirements that was against us or you, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross, having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. So, let no one judge according to food and to drink, or regarding to festivals or new moons and Sabbaths. Don't let me get into new moons and blood moons, which are a shadow of things to come, but the substance is of Christ. So everything has been fulfilled. Everything is sweet now. You lie up and you're buried and raised from the dead. Same visions and dreams that I had before I got baptized. So there's nothing against you anymore. Now 1 Peter 3:21, the Amplified, says it so beautifully. And baptized, which is a figure of their deliverance, does not now also have... now also save you from inward questionings and fears. Not by the removing of outward filth, but by bathing, but by providing you with the answer of a good, clear conscience, inward cleanness, and peace before God. Because you are demonstrating what you believe in to be yours through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So now when you get baptized, you have all this in questioning, am I really saved? Oh, am I really going to be, oh, you know, does God really love me? It destroys that. It removes that stuff, you know. And also now you're demonstrating what God has done for you outwardly by faith. Also you see as well the same thing when Jesus was crucified on the cross and they put the pierce on his side, blood and water came out, signifying the new birth. Okay? When there's circumcision, blood comes, whatever. Now what? Now you're going to be circumcised from this world. You're in it, not part of it. And the water comes. There's a new birth for you today. Okay? Because of this, in Romans 5, talks about now, because of Jesus Christ, you have peace with the Father. So you have peace, not pieces. Does God love me? Don't love me? And you're sweet with the Lord. You're one. It's awesome. Hebrews 10 verse 19 to, you know, verse 22 or 23 says, therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus. You have boldness. Fear of the Lord, the fear of the Lord. No, you already have the fear of the Lord. You don't have to fear the Lord anymore. You enter His presence with boldness. We have this bad saying that says, you know what? We need to preach the fear of the Lord. But what does the Bible say? The Bible says the beginning of wisdom is to fear the Lord. Romans Proverbs 8 says, what is the fear of the Lord? To hate evil. Do you hate evil? Yes, so you fear the Lord. Do you sometimes do evil? Yes, then repent and ask God's forgiveness and move on. It says, by a new and living way, which was consecrated for us through the veil, that is the flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with true hearts in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast our confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promises is faithful. So there's no more fears and stuff and anything for you anymore. I'm almost finished. Coming in for the landing. So I'm coming now in for the freaky thing. Okay? I want you to show the truth, trueness of what does baptism truly mean. I'm going to tell you it means you don't have to die physically anymore. Woo-hoo! Okay? Relax. So I want to show you what it true, what the scriptures mean. So I try to explain to people, you cannot read the word of God out of your carnality. Death has been defeated. Now it says in Romans 6 from verse 1, it says here, what shall we then say? Shall we continue in sin that grace abounds? Because it talks about where sin abounds, much more grace abounds. It says no. Now that you are baptized and stuff and you're doing all the stuff and you've got Jesus, doesn't mean you should keep on in your sin. Doesn't mean you should know, because that's what the Corinthians did in 1 Corinthians. They just received all these gifts and they kept on sinning. The one was sleeping with his father's wife and back and forth, and they thought, that's okay. But it costs people. The wage of sin is death. Not good. Watch this. So we continue in sin so grace abound more? No. It says, it's certainly not. How shall we, those who died to sin, live together any long to it? So we died to sin. You can't live to it anymore. Or do you not know that as many of us were baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death? So this baptism means you're going to be in the grave and out of the grave. You see what we just did in 2 Colossians as well, the same thing. It says here, therefore we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ has raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. When Jesus died and rose from the dead, he was glorified. Isn't it right? Death couldn't have him. Am I right? It says, for if we have been united together in likeness of his death. Okay? Likeness with his death. Certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. So he's saying, okay, so you died and rose from the dead. You will look just like Jesus. His resurrected life. But Johan, we don't see it now. We don't see the glorification yet. No, because we are renewing our minds. But I'm preaching what the Bible says. Call those things if not as though they were. I'm confessing it. I'm believing it. I refuse to die. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away. It says the body of sin. It never said the spiritual thing. It said the body. That thing that you can pinch. Okay. A sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. So this body has got nothing, no hold on me. That's why I'm God conscious, not sin conscious. Do you hear what I'm saying? So I say, oh, I did this. That's not you. You're dead to sin. You might make mistakes, but you're dead to sin. For he who has died has been freed from sin. So baptism means died and rise means you're free from sin. Isn't it right? This is what the Bible says, Romans 6. So I'm just quoting what the Bible says. I'm giving you secondhand revelation here. Okay? Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. Interesting, huh? Bible said that. Knowing that Christ had been raised from the dead, dies no more. So Christ, he didn't come die. That's what people said. One Father, Son. There was one death. One baptism, okay? It says, no, he died once. He's not going to die again. It says, yes. It says, now knowing that Christ has been raised from dies no more. Death no longer has dominion over him. Is it right? Now read the next verse. For the death that he died to sin once for all. Once for all. But the life that he lives in God. Now he says, okay, so once for all. No more death for everybody. Not just for him, for everybody. He died physically, he rose physically, not a spiritual death. There's no such thing as a spiritual death. Satan wished he could die spiritually. Second 11, listen to this. Likewise, you. Likewise, you, say me. Also reckon yourself to be dead indeed to sin. The wage of sin is death. So if you're dead to sin, you can't die. But alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Okay. So you're dead to this stuff. People say, but that's too much, Johan. No, it's too little. There's too many scriptures. But I'm going to give you a last one so you can understand and be freaked out and meditate on this. I say to people, why do you preach this one? Because I have to preach this. Because people are dying, and of course why? Christians is dying and they don't know why. I say to people, aim for life. Aim for life. If you should miss it, you still aim for life. To die is actually almost blasphemy to the Lord. Because he died so that we can. John 10:10 says, I came to give you life abundant to the full till it overflows. Not for you to die. John 11, I'll close with this. And you can fight with Jesus, not me. Is that okay? Now this is Lazarus. You know Lazarus died? No. Because we talk about death, burial, baptism. That's what we're going to. You know, Lazarus died. He picked. Now he died, and Jesus took his time, and for 4 days he left him, so he was stinking. He was a stinker, okay? Now why did Jesus leave him 4 days? Because the Jewish custom was that the spirit of man leaves after 4 days. So that after 4 days, they can still roam the earth like ghosts, like it's here on TV, you know, stuff. And on the fourth day, they leave. Heaven or hell, whatever. Sheol or whatever. But Jesus did it willfully, okay? Because they couldn't say, oh, but he was really risen. No, it was here. So that's not a real resurrection. Okay? That's why Jesus did it. But it says here. I want you to see here now. This is us now. When we hear this stuff. And hear what Jesus says. It says here. From verse 20. And then Martha, John 11 from verse 20. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would have not died. When Jesus rose people from the dead, I mean, come on. But even now I know that whatever you ask, God will give to you. Okay? No, but whatever God gives you. And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. So I say to you, he will rise again. And now what do we think? Your mother said, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last days. No, he won't rise. But one day when you come back, you will rise again. I've risen people from the dead. I've risen my sister twice out of dead over the phone. And a lady dropping dead in this church was resurrected here. So I know when people die, okay? So, but people say, no, it's for when those days. No, we can't resurrect people now. No, you can. It's possible. But we, no. One day when Jesus comes, he will rise. One day, now. Now faith is, the kingdom of God is now. Righteousness, peace, joy, and the Holy Ghost. Then Jesus says this. Master said to him, I know that you will rise in a resurrection day. Jesus said to him, I am the resurrection. One. I am the life. Two. So Jesus is two things. Resurrection and life. Am I right? Two things. He who believes in me, so you believe in him, no? Though he might die, he shall live. So the first thing is resurrection. So if he should peck, don't worry, you'll rise with me one day. No problem. But listen to the second verse. Freaks people out. Because people never preach on that. They're scared. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. And what does he say straight after this? Do you believe this? Read the Amplified says, they will surely never die immortality. Do you hear what I'm saying? This is what Jesus is saying. So I'm saying to people, don't believe what I'm saying, but that's what the baptism does. That's what the Holy Spirit does. I refuse to die till Jesus tells me to come. But why did these disciples die and stuff like that? They wanted to die. John, you know, a disciple John, he never died. You know that? They couldn't kill him. They tried to cut off his head, boil him in water. They did all kinds of stuff. They could not kill him, so they banished him to the Isle of Patmos. Paul, why did Paul die? He wanted to die. He never felt worthy to live. Do you understand what I'm saying? We look at this, what, you know? Yeah, but you want this and this. There's too many questions to answer now. But I want you to understand this. Aim for life. Why do people don't want to get old? Because I'm getting old and sick and I don't want to go like that. That's why you're going to get that. I refuse. I can get old. God came to restore all things or some things that Adam lost. All. So in the Old Testament, they lived till how many years? 900, 400. Not tell me the years were different. Why not now? Question mark. So rather aim for life and miss it than aim for death and you'll get death. So through baptism, we're going to die and rise and say no evil, no sickness, no disease will touch this body. I refuse that sickness and disease take this body. Smith Wigglesworth, he struggled with so much stuff in his life, but then he got it and suddenly he walked in such power. He chose to give up his spirit. Like Jesus on the cross, he gave up his spirit. So you can choose to live or to die. When people are dying, they say, that person chose to die. But they didn't. Somebody killed him. No, so you choose to die. Bible says, I set before you life and choose. Fight with Jesus. Radical stuff. But it's true to change your life, people. It's here to change your life. It will challenge you. Because sometimes you'll feel like death. Sometimes you'll be challenged with sickness. Sometimes you'll be challenged with stuff. But I refuse to believe what I see, touch, taste, and feel. I believe what Jesus said. If death was so real, if they say death is natural and normal, then why do we have hospitals? Why do we try to save people's lives and say, oh, that's his time. Let him die. While they're trying to save people's lives. Okay? I want you to understand, baptism brings us life. This is life, people. But people do die, Christians do die, because they have no understanding about this stuff. So they actually are killing themselves. Okay? Or they're believing wrong. Whatever man's believing in heart, so be. I know people, let me explain you the power of belief. This is a true story. True Snanish Kupela. A year, 2 years ago, it actually happened. Was at the gym stuff. This actually really happened. This one lady, she went to the doctor and she went for a scan and stuff and whatever. Then she came back in whatever at home and later in the week she got a phone call. She says, sorry ma'am, we just got your reports back. Please can you come see the doctor? Went to the doctor and stuff and he says, very bad, my dear. I says, you got cancer. You've got literally like 2 months to live. This is very bad. Okay, and she really took it hard. So what she did is she made plans, she did everything, said goodbye, said whatever, and there's 2 months and whatever. So what happened at the end of the day, she really made amends with everybody and stuff and whatever. 2 months passed basically and she died. she died. A couple of weeks later, somebody phoned, I think she stayed with the mom or something, whatever. Somebody answered the phone, whatever. It says, please, is Mrs. So-and-so here? I said, no, she's actually passed away. It says, but what is this for? Now, this is the labs coming back. It says, no, her scans and stuff was perfect. She's clean. There's nothing wrong with her. This lady took that report and believed she's going to die. What happened to her? She died healthy. She actually died healthy. Do you know there's a syndrome that women can actually will themselves pregnancies? You know there's a thing? You know? False pregnancies, they will themselves, stuff like that. Strange stuff that people can do by the power of what they believe. Strange people. Whatever man believes in his heart, so he will be. If you believe you're going to live 80, you die. If you live 80, you're going to die. This is one lady as well. I can tell you stories. I'm just encouraging. I know I'm taking my time, but I want to get this through. Okay? She went to a palm reader. She says, in this palm reader, she took it up because the word comes. This palm reader stuff is evil. Bad stuff, people. Palm reader says, I see that you're going to see a light, and I saw the light, and you're going to die. Met her and whatever, like she told me the story. And what only after the fact I heard this, and her sister told me the stuff. She did get born again, but she never let go of that word that was spoken into her life. She lived with that fear because this palm reader gave her that word. What happened? She praised God. She got born again, but she never left this word. She took that word. One morning she was driving. Okay, and this is, they told me the story. And apparently what happened, the light was so bright with the sun that she couldn't see. And the light shined into her eyes. Well, the car was very bright. And apparently she couldn't see. She hit into another car and she died in a car accident. Interesting that. This is stuff we need to be careful about. This is not condemnation. I want you to see this stuff. That we enter into life abundant to the full, to the overflows. So I have to give you the truth, and what you do with that, you can judge me or not, say I'm stupid or not, but you choose. Okay? My life is increasing. The Bible says, if you do not believe what I preach, like Jesus said, believe the works that I do, believe my fruits. Amen. Amen. Amen.